Right, good evening, and thanks to Andy and Terry for the introduction there. But, and Terry, I would actually have got your question wrong, because the aspect of Apollo 17 that I would have chosen as unique was the fact that it launched at night, which is one, you know, there's a few possibilities there, aren't there? But anyway, I'm going to talk about some of that this evening, because I'm going to talk about a bit of history, a bit of Apollo history, and a few things that have happened since. Before I move on to really what is coming up over the next few years, and indeed the Artemis mission started last year and moves on slowly, so it's one of those things where I think Artemis hasn't got the same deadline applied to it that John F. Kennedy applied to Apollo, but it's moving on nicely. So we'll talk a little bit about history, and we'll talk about how we got to where we are. So it all starts, really, I've talked about these things before, that yes, the Chinese were doing rockets in about the 10th century, and Robert Goddard was doing rockets in about the 1920s, but really the thing that kicked off the space race as we know it was the capture of German military rockets that were made in sort of towards the end of World War II in 1944 and 45. And in fact, I will share this with you, that my father, who is 93 years old and alive and well, is probably one of the last people left alive who actually witnessed the V2 rocket exploding over London in November 1944. And such was the meticulous nature of the records that the Germans kept, even though they were at war. On the modern internet, you can actually find the name of the Obergruppenführer who gave the launch order, and which one it was. It came down over Ilford in East London and exploded prematurely in 1944. So it was really the capture of the manufacturing facilities by the Russians and the personnel by the Americans that kicked off the two sort of arms of that technology that led to the space race. And really that started with Sputnik in 1957, when the Russians launched a satellite with a radio transmitter on, beeping all over the world, and it terrified the Americans, so they got various strands of work together and formed NASA in 1958. And then in 1961, the Soviet Union put a man in space, Yuri Gagarin. Some say he wasn't the first one, some say that he was just the first one they got back, but not quite true. They did send up an astronaut called, I think, Igor Ivanovich, before Gagarin, but the thing was, he was a crash test dummy, and that seems an eminently sensible thing to do. He wasn't real, but you know how information coming out of the Soviet Union was in 1961. We didn't really get very much of it. John F. Kennedy got his deputy, Lyndon B. Johnson, to find a challenge that the Americans could do that the Russians couldn't, and they came up with this wonderful idea, and it came down to the simple mission statement: to land a man on the moon and return him safely to the Earth by the end of the decade. So you've got everything there. You've got a challenge and a way of coming out of that challenge, getting him back to Earth safely, and a deadline, the end of the decade, which, depending on how you count these things, was either 1969 or 1970. But they did it in 1969 anyway. So three projects: Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo. And they worked towards that goal. The Mercury was a single-man rocket, and that was all about just going up and coming down and learning how to do that. Gemini was a two-man craft, and they learned all about maneuvering and docking and doing things with multiple spaceships. And then Apollo was a three-man capsule, and where they learned to go to the moon and land on it and come back. So they achieved the Apollo goal on the 24th of July 1969 with the safe return of the Apollo 11 crew. And two of those crew, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin, had, of course, walked on the moon for a period of 2 hours or so, and done a bit of science and collected a lot of rock and come back. There were more Apollo missions. This is 11. This is the landing sequence for you.
Arrived at the moon on Saturday, July 19th.
When we did get close.
close, and we rolled out and saw it for the first time. It was a revelation. It was gigantic. It filled our entire window.
The next day, Sunday, July 20th, was landing.
And a lot of anticipation. We finally come to the day, the moment, that this is about to commence.
Landing on the moon was absolutely the most difficult piece of any Apollo mission. Okay? Think about it as a controlled fall out of lunar orbit. The problem is, in this controlled fall out of orbit, you only have enough fuel for one try.
Captain, we're
the trajectory had been wrong. They were targeted into this inhospitable place. Then they had to fly over this area at high forward velocity, then pitch up to slow down so it killed at forward velocity, and then start down like a helicopter. So now we're critical fuel state. And that's why the 60-second call was given, and then the 30-second call.
Then I really got nervous. Was going up 20 milliseconds of fuel left, and then 20 seconds of fuel. Oh, jeez.
Okay, engine stop. ATA at a descent. Pump control, both autos, descent into command, override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in. We copy you down, Eagle. Tranquility base here. The Eagle has landed. Roger, 20. Tranquility, we copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
The landing to me was a great celebration. The nation was almost euphoric.
Well, it proved that the United States could accomplish tremendous goals if we worked together as a team.
So there you go, that's 53 and a bit years ago, 54 and a bit years ago, 1969. And what a fantastic achievement that was. There were more Apollos after that, up to Apollo 17, which was the last of the moon landings. And each one was longer and better than the ones before. From Apollo 15 onwards, they actually took up electric cars. So they were driving electric cars on the moon in 1971, which I think is quite extraordinary. But they rearranged those flight crews, having cancelled Apollos 18, 19 and 20 to make way for Skylab and to end the Apollo program, to release more money for things like the Vietnam War that were wanting money at that time. They rearranged the flight crews so that Harrison Schmitt became the first and only scientist to walk on the moon, and he was a geologist, so it was kind of essential that they got in there. Most of the others were test pilots, naval pilots, and so on. But we did actually, at the end, Apollo 17 took a scientist to the moon, which was great. This is the end of Apollo 17. So that was the launch of Challenger, the lunar module of Apollo 17 from the moon in 1972. And of course, the conspiracy theorists, as you can imagine, love that one, because it's quite obvious that there's a cameraman on the camera still on the moon, isn't there? Well, it's not, of course. He was operating the camera remotely from Mission Control Houston. He thought, well, you know, with all the time lags and everything, how did that work? And the answer is, that wasn't his first attempt, it was his third attempt, because Apollos 15 and 16 also had a lunar rover with a camera on and a direct radio link to Earth, and that's how they made it work. But he missed the first two times, but he got it right the third time, fortunately, because there was no fourth time, because that was the end of the moon. One of the other things about all of this that I will tell you now is that where we're going back to the moon, if you have a look at footage like that, television cameras of the time were really truly awful. But what we're looking forward to is that footage from the moon will be in 1080p, 4K, 8K even. The most fantastic pictures we've ever seen from the moon will be coming from Artemis. So let's have a look. Well, okay, so there was a program running alongside this called Apollo Applications. And Apollo Applications was a whole bunch of ideas for what else can we do with the Saturn V rocket. Once we can actually get into low Earth orbit and carry quite a lot of equipment, what else can we do with the Saturn V? So there were ideas. There was Skylab, the space station in low Earth orbit. Apollo Venus. Now, how ambitious is this? A one-year manned mission to fly by Venus and come back to the Earth. They did actually plan all that out. Didn't do it. Then they were wanted to do extended lunar missions and a base and make it fairly easy to go back and forth from the Earth to the Moon. And of all those things that they thought of, they only did two, and one was Skylab. They did actually build Skylab, and one of the curious things about Skylab, that, and it will come up later, is that Skylab itself was launched unmanned on a Saturn V rocket, the last Saturn V to launch in May 1973. But the crew went up to it in three shifts in Skylab 2, 3 and 4, and each of those was a smaller rocket, a Saturn 1B, that could take three men up in an Apollo capsule, but only to low Earth orbit, not to the Moon. And that's what they did also with the last of the Apollos, which was not called Apollo 18, it was called the Apollo-Soyuz Test Project of 1975. And that was important as well, because what they did there was they took up the last Apollo and docked it with a Russian Soyuz craft. And the astronauts met in the middle, shook hands and went on board each other's craft. They all learned to speak each other's languages and trained together and stuff. And the important thing of that was they built the interface between Russian and American electronics, which are completely otherwise incompatible. And that came in handy years down the line when, again, the Russians and Americans started working together, and we'll see that in a minute. And that was the end of Apollo. We came all this way to explore the Moon, and the most important thing is that we discovered the Earth. That's the words of Bill Anders, lunar module pilot on Apollo 8, who took that photograph, which completely boosted the ecology movement into action in 1968. And that's probably the most lasting memory of Apollo for most of us, that picture shows our Earth with another celestial body in the foreground from a long distance away. And you think, yep, tiny and insignificant, but also very beautiful. Next up, they built the Space Shuttle. This was the idea that we'd be going back and forth to low Earth orbit routinely. The original target was that we'd be going up and down once every 2 weeks. Didn't work out that way, of course. But they built the shuttle, and it took ages and ages to get the shuttle going. One of the ideas of the shuttle in its early phases was to rescue Skylab and boost it up into a higher orbit. Trouble was that Skylab crashed into Australia in 1979, and the first shuttle didn't launch till 1981, so that idea didn't work. So the shuttle was a different kind of a spacecraft. It was probably in many ways a much more elegant and real spacecraft than the Apollo, in that it takes off like a rocket, but it comes into land like a plane, indeed as a glider, in fact. And it sits on that huge booster stack, which takes it up for the first part of the way, burning a great deal of fuel. Similar power to a Saturn V, that booster stack, sort of around the 7.5 million pounds of thrust sort of thing. But a very, very powerful booster, but comes back with no power at all as a glider. And there were 135 missions of the shuttle doing various things. In the early days, they did a lot of science in low Earth orbit, but then the latter part of its existence, its job was to build the International Space Station. Unfortunately, there were two launch failures, both of them involving seven fatalities. Challenger in January 1986 exploded on the way up. The solid rocket booster leaked and set fire to the fuel in the big tank, and that was pretty much the end of that. They held a big inquiry about it, suspended launches for a couple of years, built a fifth shuttle. They originally built four shuttles, but they built the fifth one, Endeavour, which was more or less a sort of a spare parts bin special to replace Challenger. First flight of the shuttle was 12th of April 1981, exactly 20 years after Gagarin's first flight into space. And the last flight of the shuttle was the 21st of July 2011. Now, I'll just talk a little bit about something that I've always thought was quite a brave thing that they did. Actually, it's George W. Bush who made the decision, and you can take or leave George W. Bush, but I think in this instance he did the right thing. And what happened after the Columbia disaster was that the inquiry concluded that the shuttle was completely unsafe and should be stopped immediately. And the trouble with that was that had that advice been followed, we'd have completely lost the space station. We wouldn't have half the space station we have today. And what George W. Bush said, he said, "I want you to find a way of doing this under conditions of extreme safety so we can finish the space station." And that's what they did. And I kind of reckon that if they'd taken safety as seriously as they had, you know, at the end, from the beginning, there probably wouldn't have been two launch failures. But that's just my view of it. That's not the history that we lived through. There were two shuttles lost, unfortunately, which, you know, think of it as 40% of those they built blew up. That's bad, isn't it? Here's one launching. This is STS-125. This is the last mission to the Hubble Space Telescope. Watch the launch sequence. You see thousands of gallons of water dumped, then the main engine start and nothing happens, and then 6 seconds after that the boosters fire, then it goes. There's the water. There's the main engines. Now 6 seconds. There's the boosters. So there you go, the space shuttle put Hubble into orbit, it fixed it when it wasn't quite working properly, and then it upgraded it twice more before that date, May 2009 there, where the last mission, and nearing the end, STS-125, the last one was 135 in 2011, so that was towards the end of the life of the shuttle. There, that one is probably not quite unique in that the safety plans that they put in place post-2003 requires that the shuttle's underside was inspected from the space station. And this one wasn't going to the space station, so they did take a bit of a risk with it. But they did it anyway because so that we could see better things through the Hubble Space Telescope, which we undoubtedly have done. Okay, so the move on from there, the shuttle program ended, but before it ended, it did finish building the space station, and this was envisaged originally as Space Station Freedom by the Americans in the 1980s. It was going to be a wholly American project, and in the end, they decided that was all far too expensive and complicated. They needed to bring in other sponsors. And so in the end, we had the United States, Russia, Japan, ESA in Europe, and Canada all work together on the International Space Station. And one of the benefits that we get from that here is that we can see the International Space Station go past on certain evenings and mornings here. Very bright object, as bright as the planet Venus. And you can see it takes about 5 minutes to go across the sky at 17,500 miles per hour. The reason why we can see it here, this is not really an ideal latitude to put a space station into, 51.6 degrees north, which means it's never straight above us, but can be halfway up the sky from this latitude. It needed to be seen from Moscow to get Russian money, and that's why that is. So it's not all a bad thing at all. There she is, there's the International Space Station. Few years life in her yet. We're not quite sure what they're going to end up doing with it. There are now plans talking about deorbiting it. There comes a point when it is old and creaky and either needs a lot of work or needs to be replaced with something bigger and better. But we are coming towards that time when those decisions are going to have to be made. Right, so the first attempt of thinking about going back to the moon. Towards the end of the 2000s, they started working on this, and they built the Orion capsule. And the Orion capsule is like an Apollo on steroids. It's a six-man version of an Apollo. A lot more in it, a lot better, quite a bit bigger too. Same basic shape though. If you looked at one, you say, oh yes, that's come from Apollo. And they built that, and then they were going to have put that on two sorts of rocket. One was the Ares-1, and just on my picture here, the little one there is the Ares-1. They called that the stick. And what that basically consists of is a solid rocket booster from a shuttle. And then on top of that is a second stage with cryogenic fuels, working a conventional way with them. And they looked at different sorts of engines for that. They ended up going back to a space shuttle main engine. I think they were looking at different engines. Likewise, the much bigger Ares-5, and the idea was, this goes back to that Skylab idea, where you separate out the idea of the big rocket taking the cargo up and the little rocket taking the men up. And that's what Skylab did, and that's what Ares-1 and 5 were expected to do. Never turned out that way, because they built an Ares, or Ares-1X as it was called, and they only did half a test mission on that, the bottom half, which I suppose is obvious, but and they never completely built the Ares-5 at all. It never went beyond a prototype, never launched, and the whole thing got canned when President Obama came into office because he wanted something better, and that was probably a good call too. But here's the Ares-1X launch.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Ignition. Liftoff of Ares-1X. Testing concepts for the future of new rocket design. Now passing Mach 2, vehicle now.
miles altitude downrange distance, 8 miles, a velocity of 1,540 miles per hour. Plus 80 seconds, we started our supersonic large amplitude IED maneuver PTI, and we see the response. And we started the last PTI maneuver, structural mode IED, and we passed T plus 105 seconds. Plus now traveling Mach 4, 20 miles altitude, downrange distance 32 miles. The SRM tail off is observed. Burnout. Our APUs have shut down. CRDs have shut down. BDF fire. And set. We show a set and a tumble motor ignition. And we can also confirm on video. We see both parts of the vehicle tumbling. The first stage as well as the upper stage. Successful separation. Good clean signal all the way. T plus 150 seconds.
And the second stage on this occasion was not a fueled rocket even. It was only a test of the first stage. Okay, this was the second attempt at going back to the moon, which was Artemis. And it was largely evolved from the Constellation project and the Ares rockets. They kept particularly Orion. The Orion capsule was looking well designed and fit for purpose, so they kept that. But then they rejigged the whole of everything else, and they built the Block 1 Space Launch System. Now, the Space Launch System was very much conceptually like an Ares 5. It was a full power thing. It used cryogenic fuels, liquid hydrogen, liquid oxygen, and used RS-25D engines, all that had previously flown on the Space Shuttle. They actually kept those engines. They were fantastically good engines, designed from the outset to be reusable, and they sort of took them in, overhauled them, and used them again. They also had, assist those four rockets there, they're 5.5 stage solid rocket boosters, which is an upgraded version of the ones used on the Space Shuttle, and the Orion capsule, which was uncrewed for the first mission, Artemis 1. So let's go and have a look at what Artemis 1 did. It was the left of those four variants. There are four variants of the SLS, Space Launch System. Block 1, Block 1B is a bit bigger. Block 1B cargo is just differently configured to take stuff rather than the Orion capsule. And the SLS Block 2 cargo is even bigger. So they'll take quite substantial amounts of equipment to low Earth orbit, or lesser amounts to the moon. This is Artemis 1. Now, it's a very complicated flight plan, although it's really sort of doing a very much supercharged version of what Apollo 4 did. Apollo 4 launched and did a sort of a fake moon mission in which it didn't go to the moon. What it actually did was it went up and then got itself to a great height and then fired the rocket directly towards the Earth so that it arrived at the Earth at a speed as if it was coming from the moon. Artemis 1 has done a lot better than that because it's actually been to the moon. It went around the moon, but unmanned, of course, uncrewed, as I'm supposed to say these days. But it went into a lunar orbit, then into a very large retrograde lunar orbit, and came back about, I think it was 20-something days later. So quite a long mission, and the idea was just to test everything out on an uncrewed vehicle. And it passed all that with flying colours. This is Artemis 1.
Our return to the moon will be different than the last time. We plan to explore more of the lunar surface and
the Space Force system is now counting down to lift off of Orion on its maiden voyage to the moon. And here we go. Hydrogen burn off igniters initiated. 7, 6, 5. Force engage engine start. 3, 2, 1. Boosters and engines. And lift off of Artemis 1. We rise together, back to the moon and beyond.
We are all part of something incredibly special, the first launch of Artemis.
So there you go, that was the uncrewed test of Artemis, the Artemis 1 mission, and that was less than a year ago now. It was actually November of last year, and running into December. It did, although it was uncrewed, it did go further from the Earth than any of the Apollos. And it would be one of Terry's teaser questions as to which Apollo went the furthest with men on, and that was actually Apollo 13. And the reason for that is because they didn't land on the moon. They had to go a little bit past it to turn around and come back. But Apollo 13 did, or does still, hold the crewed altitude record. But Artemis will probably beat that. That certainly Artemis 1 did so, except it had no crew. So, of Artemis 2 we're coming up to now, and this is the one they're trying to put together at the moment and making good progress with, actually, because they have now got the core rocket together with its engines, its four RS-25 engines attached to the body of the craft. It's going to be a four astronaut mission, and the mission is to confirm all the spacecraft systems operate as designed with crew aboard in the actual environment of deep space. 8-day mission, currently looking at November 2024, so a year's time. Expect that to slip, as everything with Artemis does. The Artemis 1 mission that we just looked at was originally going to happen in 2018. Well, it took 4 years later than that. So it gives you an idea that, and it's quite right that they do things properly and don't take unnecessary risks. I think if you look back at Apollo, they did take risks that were quite amazing, actually, at the time. And part of the reason they stopped was actually that. It wasn't just about money. So Artemis 2 is all coming together. I'll talk a little bit about underneath Orion. Just underneath Orion, you'll see there's a sort of cylindrical part of the craft, and that is the European Space Agency service module. So none of Orion works without its service module, and that is the rocket that goes behind the Orion capsule and takes all the things that they need to the moon with them. And it's European. It's actually made by Airbus in Germany, with help from a few others, and it takes mostly propellant. It weighs 13.5 tons, bringing the total weight of the Orion spacecraft to about 20 tons in total. And there's its mission patch, and they've actually got a couple of patches now. Well, I picked that one out because it shows the craft the way you'd want to see it with the single engine on the back of it. This is a much simpler mission profile, actually, than Artemis 1 was. In that it simply goes into Earth orbit, goes up, around the moon, and comes back. Which actually, even though it's crewed, that is a less sophisticated flight plan than Apollo 8. Because Apollo 8 did something very similar, except it also went into 10 orbits around the moon. This isn't doing that. It's spending 6 days going there and back. Artemis 2, when we get to see it, probably 2025, I would, if I were a betting man, I'd probably say something like that. So that's Artemis 2. Here's the astronauts. They've been selected. Reid Wiseman, Victor Glover, Christina Koch from NASA, and Jeremy Hansen from the Canadian Space Agency. That's them all suited up. And here's a little video about them. When they say launching soon, I think that's for quite large values of soon, really. Probably more than a year away, but it's all coming along. And I do follow the blogs. If you look at both NASA and ESA websites, they've both got blogs, and which you do get a lot of updates on what's happening with Artemis on there. So Artemis 2 coming soon. Okay, now then, this is starts to get serious now, and it also starts to get a bit indistinct. One of the things when I was doing all my research for this was trying to pin down, know exactly what are you going to do. And Artemis 3 is where it starts to come a little bit fuzzy. Because there was a perfectly good plan to make Artemis 3 the first moon landing since 1972. It may well happen, but you may have to wait till 4. 3 may be, some are saying, a full dress rehearsal like Apollo 10 was for Apollo 11. Something like that, because it is complex, and they're doing it a way that is very, very complex, because Apollo did it the easiest way possible, where you land near the lunar equator. You have a free return trajectory orbit. Most Apollos did. That is to say that if anything goes wrong, you just go past and you come back again all by itself. Apollo 13 had a slightly non-return trajectory built in, which is why they needed a rocket burn to get back. These are completely different. These Artemis missions are completely different, and they've amalgamated two different ways of going to the moon. If I go back to about 1964, when they were looking at Apollo, they considered three different means of going to the moon, and one was simply going to the moon. You build a great big rocket, you send it to the moon, you land, you take off from the moon, you come back. Way two was building a rocket bit by bit in Earth orbit and sending that to the moon and coming back. Way three, which is what they did, was where you launch a very complex rocket stack, including two craft, the Apollo and the lunar module, only one of which goes down to the moon and comes back and docks with the rest and then comes back together, and you ditch the lunar lander at that point. The Artemis landers are going to do this different ways, the way that you actually have multiple launches from Earth, one of which is the lunar lander, which is actually, as it turns out, is now contracted to SpaceX. The SpaceX Starship will be the lunar lander, and the SLS and Orion will be the main crew craft. And they will dock in lunar orbit, and then the SpaceX lander will go down. There's a refinement of that coming along with Artemis 4 and onwards, where they put a little space station around the moon, and then that becomes the place where everyone docks, and they go down to the moon and back from there. So whether Artemis 3 will do this all in one go, I don't know, but that was the plan. So let's have a look at it. Okay, so Gateway. This is the Gateway. This is the little space station they're looking at building in lunar orbit. Where's my picture? There it is. That's the first two parts of it, and other parts will be sent up in further Artemis missions and further SpaceX missions to put that lunar space station together, the Lunar Gateway, or just Gateway, they're calling it. There will be, now this is the thing, they want to go to the South Pole. The South Pole is really very interesting. There are places on the South Pole where the temperatures don't vary too much. Actually on the lunar equator it's extremely hot in the day and it's totally freezing at night because there is no atmosphere as such. But near the South Pole there's areas, well there's, you know, there's a bit of sideways light coming in from the sun and then there's not, and it doesn't actually necessarily, you know, the temperature doesn't vary too much. There may also in some of those craters be ice. And that's one of the things they'll be looking for on the first missions, is there ice there? Because if you've got water in the form of ice, that makes a huge difference to the whole long-term habitability of the moon. So there is this orbit that they've got, the near rectilinear halo orbit, which is a polar elliptical orbit around the moon. So orbit around from the Earth is like that. This orbit would be like that, and it's very elliptical. To have a close approach to the moon at one end, but also a 6.5 days duration. And that means that if you wanted to go to a part of the moon, you could have your spacecraft in this orbit, and the bit that you take down to the ground lands, and then you do your expedition, and 6.5 days later you go and meet it where it was before. It comes back to the same place. So it's a little bit confusing, but that's roughly what they're trying to do with Artemis 3. Let's have a look at that.
Artemis is our 20%.
This is selecting the landing points. Tells you a bit about that.
NASA, international space agencies, and a growing global space industry will explore Earth's nearest neighbor with advanced robotics and our next generation of astronauts. But where will our astronauts explore? The moon is a treasure trove of scientific discovery, and NASA has its sights set on the South Pole. This mysterious region features soaring mountains and deep craters, leading to unique locations that experience nearly continuous sunlight, in contrast to nearby depressions that never see the sun. Artemis 3 will mark humanity's return to the lunar surface for the first time since 1972. NASA has identified 13 regions near the South Pole that meet safety requirements for landing and present opportunities to search for lunar resources. Each region can also help us learn more about the history of the moon and gain a better understanding of our place in the solar system. These 13 candidate landing regions represent a diversity of features in the lunar South Pole, ranging from the summits of mountains rising miles above their surroundings to the rims of large craters. These features together act to both expose and preserve billions of years of geologic history. Using robotic orbiters and rovers, NASA and the global science community will continue to study these regions before selecting the Artemis 3 landing site. The astronauts selected for this bold expedition will literally and figuratively shine a light on some of the deepest, darkest areas of the solar system, revealing ancient secrets of the universe.
So there you go, it all starts to get exciting at Artemis 3, doesn't it, when they actually get into landing. Well, hopefully that one will land, but Artemis 4 most certainly wouldn't. There's the mission profile, and if you see this, it's got this polar elliptical orbit here. If you look at the detail there, there's Orion and a smaller landing craft there. If we go on to Artemis 4, you'll see that changes slightly, but that's the general idea. This is the gateway, and this is the future of the gateway, starting off with the first two modules that we looked at on the previous picture, but then with lots and lots of new modules to add to that so that it becomes a fully fledged space station around the moon. So a lot to look forward to there. You're looking there into the 2030s, I would say, before that all comes to fruition. So there. Artemis 4, again, much the same, only more so, because this, oops. Wrong button. Yeah. Artemis 4, yeah, you've now got the actual gateway in that orbit there, that rectilinear elliptical orbit. So that's Artemis 4. We'll see great pictures, no doubt, from Artemis 4, I hope. And subsequent missions. There's Artemis 5 again, which is more of the same, and that will probably happen, but you're looking to about 2030, I think, for Artemis 5. Then, after that, there's Artemis 6 up to 14. They've already placed the orders for booster rockets for all of those. Timescales completely uncertain. In fact, the timescales for Artemis 2 and 3 are uncertain, so you know, we just have to hope that the money keeps coming and the plans keep coming, and it all goes along well. But of course, the other thing that people talk about when talking about Artemis is Mars. And my own take on it is this. The moon is 3 days away. Mars, with current propulsion and stuff, is 6 months away. And lots of things are different over that period. And issues really that need to be solved that haven't really been solved. Radiation. Now, the Orion capsule does have some radiation shielding, and it does have an area where, in the event of solar flares and so on, people can hide away and not be so affected by it. But really, in terms of the sort of solar radiation that you could expect over a six-month period going to Mars, probably something a bit more beefy, is some other way of dealing with radiation even might be. I think if you look at Star Trek, they had shields, of course, and, you know, whilst we're not quite there yet, something like that is a great answer. Gravity. Now, going to Mars, we know from people on the space station what happens to people in microgravity or zero gravity for that length of time. And what happens really is that they become useless. Their muscles just waste away. And, you know, are you going to tell me that people are going to go to Mars for 6 months in that kind of spacecraft and get out and start digging holes? Because I just don't see that happening that way. Something a bit more like a, you know, a miniature 2001 Space Odyssey wheel with artificial gravity might be a way forward. Anything happens, no quick return to medical issues that you haven't. So you've got to take at least a bit of a hospital with you, I suppose. And this is the, you know, probably the biggest one in many ways, the psychological issues of being confined in that sort of space for 6 months. It was okay on Apollo for 3 days, but I'm not sure about Mars. So I think there's a lot of thinking to be done in terms of, you know, progress from Artemis to a Mars mission. I very much hope that I will see more men walk on the moon. I'm not sure I will see them walk on Mars. So it might happen, though. Here we are. Here's a simulated Mars landing. So watch this space. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.